to our channel. Today we are going to see the reversible injury. So whenever there can be reversible, that is injured cell can go to normal, we can have the two main features, that is the cellular swelling and fatty change. So in the cellular swelling, you can see it's because of the failure of ion pumps, especially sodium potassium pumps, because where the sodium accumulates inside a pump, inside of a cell, because of its failure, so water follows sodium and gets accumulated. And the fatty changes may be due to three reasons, that is hypoxic injury, toxic injury, or metabolic injury. So what is fatty change actually? We can see lipid vacuoles in the cytoplasm. So it is seen especially in hepatocytes, myocardial cells, because why? Because they are associated with the fat metabolism. So this is all about it. Now let us see the morphology. In morphology, we have the cellular swelling is the first manifestation of almost all forms of injury to the cell. So whenever there is a cell injury, we can see for sure a cellular swelling almost in every injury. So it is a difficult morphological change to appreciate in the light microscope. We can't see it, but it may be more apparent at the level of whole organ. When we look at the whole organ picture, then we can easily find it. When it affects many cells, it causes some pallor, increase the turgor, and also increase in the weight of organ. Because of this fatty change and cellular swelling, you know, water accumulates and fat gets increased. So of course, all this takes place, that is pallor, turgor, and also increase in the weight of organ. So on the microscopic examinations, the small clear vacuoles are found, if you remember, lipid vacuoles are found in the fatty chain. So may be seen with the cytoplasm. This represents the distended and pinched off segments of the endoplasmic reticulum. Why endoplasmic is pinched off? Because you know, accumulation of water even takes place in the organelles, leading to deattachment of ribosomes in endoplasmic reticulum, dilation, and leading to pinched off. This pattern of non-lethal injury is sometimes called the hydropic change because of water, of course. So the name hydropic change, or vacuolar degeneration. So the swelling of cells is reversible. The cells may also show increased eosinophilic staining. That is more number of eosinophils, eosinophilia, which becomes much more pronounced with the progression to necrosis. Especially necrosis, you can see eosinophilia, because necrosis is associated with inflammation. That is the reason why the eosinophils are high. And the ultrastructure changes of the reversible cell injury are the plasma membrane alterations, that is sagging, blunting, and also loss of microvilli. Why the microvilli are lost? Because if you take this as a cell, as the water gets accumulated inside the cell, the microvilli, you know, the pressure towards them created, and they destroy the microvilli. And the mitochondrial changes are including swelling and appearance of small amorphous densities. Of course, every organelle gets swelled up when water is more, and also in mitochondria there are small amorphous densities forming. And the dilation of endoplasmic reticulum with detachment of polysomes, intracytoplasmic myelin figures may be present. And the nuclear alterations are with disintegration of granular and fibrillar elements. So in the nucleus, all the granular and fibrillar elements are lost. Necrosis is mainly due to the denaturation of intracellular proteins. That is, when the proteins inside the cell are lost, it is nothing but necrosis, and also the enzymatic digestion of lethally injured cell. Now all these proteins are lost, so the enzymes, that is nothing but the lysozymes within the cells, they come and eat up that, and nothing but destroying the whole cell. So unable to maintain the membrane integrity, and the contents leak out. So when cell swells up and increase the pressure from inside, of course the membrane integrity is lost, and the contents leak out because the cell membrane is lost. So the inflammation in the surrounding tissue, why? Because all these contents are leaking out, so the inflammation cells come nearby to repair them. In the process of repair process, they try to come there and causing inflammation. And the enzymes digesting the necrotic cells from lysosomes of dying cells itself. So the dying cells, lysosomes only eat those, and the lysosomes of leukocytes, because as a part of inflammation, so as the even the cells of their own cell eat them, and also the inflammatory cells, as they are come for inflammatory reaction, they also eat these cells. Example, we can take the occlusion of coronary artery. So any block in a coronary artery is mainly due to the necrosis. So the earliest necrosis is not seen until 4 to 12 hours, because you know within the cell, these are the microscopical changes like thing which takes place within the cell, and we can't observe it, we can't understand until the cell membrane is broken, because when cell membrane is broken, all the contents leak out. So this leak out contents may also reach our blood, and when we do the blood test, we can easily understand. For example, we do troponin creatinase test in case of myocardial necrosis, so that we can understand about myocardial death. So you can see not seen until 4 to 12 hours, but later due to cell membrane loss, the contents leak out and get findable in blood after 2 hours of myocardial necrosis. To see the morphology of necrotic, the necrotic cells show the increased eosinophilia, already discussed in HND stains. We use here hematoscalin and eosin, and attributable in part to loss of cytoplasmic RNA, because all cells are eating up like lysozymes, everything. So even RNA is lost, and in a part of denatured cytoplasmic proteins, the necrotic cell may have more glassy homogeneous appearance. I think you can guess now, because everything is lost, so like empty vacuoles, so it's glassy appearance than do normal cells. So mainly as a result of the loss of glycogen particles, this takes place. Sometimes have digested the cytoplasmic organelles, the cytoplasm becomes vacuolated and appears moth-eaten. This is important. So it looks like moth-eaten. Moth, you know, it's like a butterfly. So moths, dirty moths, you know, whenever they eat anything, like eaten part here, you can see they become like moth-eaten, wholly vacuolated here, you can see. And the dead cells may be replaced by large whorled phospholipid masses called myelin figures. So now everything is lost, they come together forming a myelin figures that are derived from the damaged cell membrane itself. So this is important, myelin figures are from damaged cell membrane. So these phospholipid precipitates are then either phagocytosed by other cells or further degraded into fatty acids. If there are phagocytes, everything, you know, everything is eaten up. If not, then it may convert into fatty acids. So these fatty acids lead to calcification, results in the generation of calcium soaps. So thus the dead cells may ultimately become calcified, if not phagocytosed. Yes. And next, by electron microscopy, the necrotic cells are characterized by discontinuities in plasma and organelle membranes, because even they are eaten up by lysosomes and they are also swelled up with water. So the marked dilation of mitochondria with the appearance of large amorphous densities, intracytoplasmic myelin figures, amorphous debris and aggregates of fluffy material probably representing the denatured protein. Nuclear changes, what may be there? Because in nuclear changes also the DNA is also eaten up, it is also swollen. So appearance in one of the three patterns, all due to non-specific breakdown of DNA. The basophilia of the chromatin may fade, that is karyolysis. Karyolysis, as the name says, the chromatin is eaten up, that is a change that presumably reflects loss of DNA because of enzymatic degradation by endonuclease. So endonuclease eats our DNA. And a second pattern which is also seen in apoptotic cell death is pycnosis. So pycnosis is seen in apoptotic cell death, that is characterized by the nuclear shrinkage and increased basophilia. So pycnosis means nucleus is shrinking. First, karyolysis means because of endonuclease, DNA is breaking down. Pycnosis means shrinkage. And here the chromatin condenses into a solid. So pycnosis is shrinking. So as shrunken, everything like condensed structures. And next, shrunken basophil mass. In third pattern, karyorexis. This means the pycnotic nucleus undergoes fragmentation. So first the DNA endonucleus takes place, next they condense, next they are fragmented, cut off, finally they disappear. That's it. This is the process of disappearance of DNA. So undergoes fragmentation, and with the passage of time, a day or two, the nucleus in the necrotic cell totally disappears. So this is what happens. Now let us see the patterns of necrosis. In the patterns of necrosis, first we have the coagulative necrosis. It's nothing but the dead tissue architecture is preserved for a span of some days. It's showing a firm texture, injury, denature, proteins and enzymes. So here the injury itself denatures the proteins and enzymes and block the proteolysis of dead cells. So this is a different kind of necrosis. Actually, in our normal necrosis, where so all the proteins are eaten up, but here they block the proteolysis, that is the dead cell of dead cells. So dead cells remain itself in the cell. This is what they're saying in coagulative necrosis. So eosinophilic anucleate cells persist for days and weeks, of course, because they need to act upon them. So even they remain there. So the necrotic cells are removed by the phagocytosis. If not removed, you know, calcification, but here they are removed by phagocytosis because they are staying there for more time, so they have more chance to act on them, and they are removed by the phagocytosis. So example here, you can take the ischemia. Ischemia means low blood passage to tissues or vessels. So ischemia by obstruction in the vessel in all organs except brain. So this is where you can take the example of coagulation necrosis. Why except brain? Because in brain the liquefaction necrosis takes place. We are going to learn it next. So except brain, ischemia in vessels in all organs is mainly due to coagulative necrosis. That is the in the vessel, as the block has appeared, all the coagulative factors enter there and they just get accumulated there and they persist for more days, creating a coagulative necrosis. So a localized area of coagulative necrosis is nothing but infarct. So infarction, we know infarction, myocardial infarction. So infarct is nothing but the localized area. If for example only in the vessel some localized area, then it is known as infarct. And liquefaction necrosis, it is characterized by digestion of dead cells. So it is like our normal necrosis where we where actually the cells digest away the dead cells. So it results in the transformation of tissue to liquid viscous. As here everything is digesting, they turn into a liquid form. Seen in bacteria, fungal infections, because microbes stimulate the accumulation of leukocytes and liberate the enzymes from them. So because of this microbes, even this liquefaction becomes more amplified. So it's looking like a creamy yellow because of the load of leukocytes, dead leukocytes. So it is called pus. So pus is nothing but creamy yellow. It is mainly due to dead leukocytes. And hypoxic death in the central nervous system is often is liquefied necrosis. If you remember, here we said except brain. So here has come the brain. So in hypoxic death, especially in central nervous system, is often due to liquefied necrosis. And let's see the gangrenous necrosis. It's not specific pattern of cell death. It takes place mainly in the limb, that is the lower legs, where the blood supply is decreased and they undergo necrosis, that is coagulative. So if the coagulative necrosis taking place in our lower limbs involving many tissue planes, it is nothing but the gangrenous necrosis. So when the bacteria enter, leading to the attracted leukocytes there, giving the wet gangrene. So they form the wet gangrene, that is again nothing but liquefaction necrosis. And next, the caseous necrosis is a cheese-like form and it is mainly found in the foci of the tuberculosis. So see, cheese-like from friable white area of necrosis is a whitish area. On microscopy, it appears like a collection of fragmented or lysed cell or lysed cells and amorphous granular debris. So it fragmented cells means nothing but debris because they are already dead cells, enclosed in the inflammatory border. Of course, because inflammatory cells are around them, here all are the dead cells, so they would look like this. Characteristics of the focus of inflammation is granuloma. So if same thing, if we take this in a kind of focus only at specific point, then it is known as granuloma, that is the caseous necrosis and around all inflammatory cells. This is the granuloma. Granuloma is different from the granulation tissue, so that we need to remember. Granulation tissue is mainly formed in wound healing, but not granuloma is found in necrotic dead tissue. And fat necrosis. Fat necrosis is the focal areas of fat destruction from the pancreatic lipase into substance of pancreas and peritoneal cavity. So what happens here? Let us see example. In calmatous abdominal emergency, that is in acute pancreatitis, that is the pancreatic enzymes release out of the echinar cells. We know pancreas echine cells, actually they should act only there, but when they leak out and they liquefy the membrane of fat cells in the peritoneum. So you know, after pancreas, if they leak out, of course they enter into peritoneum, where they liquefy the membrane of the fat cells and release the lipases and split the triglycerols within the fat cells. So the fatty acids bind with the calcium and they were visible like a chalky white areas. So fat necrosis is chalky white area, caseous necrosis is cheesy like area, gangrenous necrosis contains wet gangrene in the example, that is liquefaction necrosis. And if you remember, liquefaction necrosis takes place in CNS and the coagulative necrosis takes place in ischemic all vessels except brain. So this is a quick review. So in fat necrosis, chalky white area, this is also called as fat saponification and also surrounded by an inflammatory reaction. Of course, inflammatory reaction is present in necrosis. So whenever the cell is destroyed, of course, the inflammatory cells surround them to form an inflammatory reaction. Noid necrosis. It's a special form of necrosis usually seen in immune reactions, that is involving the blood vessels. So the blood vessels, the immune reactions which are taking place in the blood vessels is nothing but fibrinoid necrosis. That is the pattern in which the complex of antigen and antibody are deposited in the walls of the arteries. So this deposition of the immune complex together with the fibrin, so this is important, hence the name fibrinoid necrosis. Not only the immune complex, along with the fibrin also accumulates this and leak out of the vessels, result in a bright pink and amorphous appearance in H&E stains. So this is fibrin-like. By pathologists, we can easily find it's like fibrin-like appearance. So immunologically mediated vasculitis syndrome in which this type of necrosis is seen. So example is immunologically mediated vasculitis syndrome. And ultimately in the living patient, most necrotic cells and their contents disappear by phagocytosis. Of course, almost in every cases, phagocytosis takes place. But if it does not take place, calcification takes place. So, of debris and enzymes by leukocytes, of course. If necrotic cells and cell are not promptly destroyed and reabsorbed, they tend to attract the calcium salts. So, they tend to attract, as the calcium salts are attracted towards them, the minerals and become calcified. This phenomena is known as dystrophic calcification. So, this is all about today's lecture.